That's true, Dr. Zayas.
Very well.
Where would we be without THC? Cause we know they're lying to us, just don't know to what degree. Yeah, where would we be without THC? The Higherside Chat Show. Greg Carlwood and company.
All right, Higherside Chatters. In a 1992 interview with a Texas journalist, George H.W. Bush was quoted in saying, if the American people knew what we've done, they'd string us up by the lampposts. And the confidence to deliver such a bold statement lies in the realization that much care and attention has gone into making sure the American people are systematically dumbed down, distracted, and thoroughly pacified into ignorance and complacency with the actions of our so-called elected government. Because the sad truth seems to be that the American populace will overlook nearly any nefarious deeds carried out in their name as long as it doesn't interfere with the addictive consumer debt cycle and, of course, the game on Sunday. Yes, people, it's no surprise your average middle-class male knows next to nothing about international drone strike campaigns, rigged elections, and fractional reserve banking, but they know just how fast their favorite athlete can throw a ball or run 40 yards. Well, hopefully today's guest, Brian Tuohy, the nation's foremost expert on game-fixing and sports conspiracies, can help to shatter some of the illusions of the sanctimonious sports industry with the information he's presented in the several books he's written about corruption, setups, illegal gambling, and wealth extraction in the sports world. With titles like The Fix Is In, The Showbiz Manipulations of the NFL, MLB, NBA, NHL, and NASCAR, Larceny Games, Sports Gambling, Game Fixing, and the FBI, and A Season in the Abyss, Sports Gambling, and the NFL's Integrity, here he is, the king of sports conspiracy. Brian, my man, welcome to the Higherside.
Hey, thanks for having me on, Greg. I appreciate it.
Yeah, no worries, man. Thanks for being here. You have such a unique expertise, and it's not like I don't have my own pointless entertainment obsessions, but I've never been a sports guy. I never understood the fanaticism, so to have a guest here who's willing to help torch up that sacred calf of sports is just the kind of troublemaking I like. And to kick this off, because it is such an underexposed realm, how did you end up becoming the go-to guy for sports corruption and conspiracies? Was there a particular sketchy game or something that set you down this path less traveled?
No, not really. It's funny. I really took this job on, and it's not a job because I really don't get paid enough, so I guess it's more or less called a hobby. But it's because no one else in the sports media world, no sports writer, no sports journalist, seemed to really want to tackle this subject in America. I mean, outside of America, if you look at Europe and elsewhere, game fixing, especially like in soccer and some in tennis, rugby, cricket, some of the other sports, is a well-known thing and people are up in arms about it all. But in the United States, the sports media is so really entwined with the sports leagues that this notion of the possibility even of games being fixed, it just doesn't exist.
Right.
So as I kind of fell into this and started doing research about it, because my wife was really one who convinced me to write a book about it. The more I fell into it, the more I realized, well, nobody's doing this. Nobody wants to, a lot of people don't even want to hear it, but, you know, nobody wants to really dig into this subject matter and realize what's going on and what's even possible. Because, as I've said on some other programs, it's like, you know, I could be 99% wrong in what I talk about games being fixed, but if I'm 1% right, that means games are being fixed, have been fixed, and not only been fixed by gamblers, but potentially by the leagues themselves.
Yeah.
So, I mean, just if I'm just a fractional right, that means really the integrity of all these sports leagues is crap.
I love it, man. And you're so right. It's important to note just how tied up and intertwined these sports leagues are with the media. There'd be no sports really without the broadcasting. And I think one big aha point you make in this regard, and one that I think will resonate with this audience pretty well, is that you should look at these corporations who carry and run the leagues, ABC, NBC, Disney, Fox, all these entertainment arms of even larger, often thought of as nefarious corporations. We don't even trust them with something as serious as reporting the news, honestly. How could we be so naive as to think that everything in a realm as trivial as sports is going to be kosher?
Well, that's just it. I mean, if I was writing a book about Goldman Sachs, or if I wrote a book about Exxon or McDonald's or some other big corporation, and I said, oh, they're up to something nefarious and they're not looking out for your best interest and they're just trying to make money, nobody would question me. They'd be, oh, yeah, I believe that. I'd go along right with whatever this guy's writing or saying. Mm-hmm. But if I say the same things about the NFL or I say the same things about the NBA, people go, wait a minute, you can't. No, what are you talking about? That's crazy talk. And it's like, well, these are businesses. They're in business. They don't put the games on for free. They're putting the games on because they want to make money, and they're making billions of dollars doing it. And there's other companies making billions of dollars on the back of these companies as well. Maybe somebody should look into this and see what's truly going on. From what I've done for my writing stuff, I've seen articles I've written, books that I've written get basically ignored and intentionally ignored by the sports media because they don't want to propagate this idea that games are fixed and the integrity of the leagues really should be questioned. And it kind of concerns me because, like you say, this is just sports we're talking about. You know, it's not something really, really important. So if they do this to me, and I, like I say, I can prove they've done it to me in terms of kind of trying to keep my stuff under wraps, who else are they silencing out there who have bigger and more important stories to tell? Because they have the power, they have the control, and it does make you sound like a conspiracy theorist when you start saying that stuff, but it's true. Yeah. They have the power to keep you out of the media, and if somebody can't learn about my books through the media, well, they're not going to really find them, and I'm not going to get my message out. So they can keep things, what I call censorship by omission. They can keep things out of the news that they want to keep out of the news.
So true. And if people go to your website, thefixisin.net, you say there that the ticket you purchased to a sporting event reflects this notion of sports being simply entertainment, and that the Spygate lawsuit proves this. Can you elaborate on that lawsuit and how it helps to make our points here?
What happened was, with the whole Spygate thing, was the New England Patriots were basically caught cheating. They were videotaping their opponents' coaching signals, and nobody really knows for how long this was going on, how effective it was, what it was really doing to the games. But the NFL, the way they reacted to it and supposedly destroyed the tapes, made a lot of people question, well, what the heck was really going on? Well, one fan, a Jets fan who happened to be a lawyer, made a class action lawsuit against the Patriots and sued them. I think it was like 10 years worth of games, saying basically that the Patriots had cheated for those 10 years and we, the fans, deserve our money back from those games. And it actually went to the Third Circuit Court of Appeals. And the ultimate ruling was by the judges there that, look, when you buy the ticket to a game, be it an NFL game, NBA game, whatever sporting event it is, you're essentially purchasing a license to be allowed into that stadium to see the event that is being put on. So in this case, you bought a ticket to see a football game. The NFL provided that football game. The Patriots provided that football game. And it doesn't mean that the football game has to be played by any certain rules. It doesn't mean that certain players have to perform. It doesn't mean a team can't cheat. Basically, you pay to see a football game. They put on a football game. That's the end of the story. That's the only recourse you have as a fan, which is zero. You can't sue the league over what they put on the field. And so, to me, that just proves that the idea that a league can fix its own game is perfectly legal because it doesn't even constitute as fraud because it is just entertainment. And even on your ticket, it says, you know, this is for entertainment purposes only. And so, therefore, there is no law that really prevents a league like the NFL or the NBA from fixing its own game because essentially their entertainment and what you're purchasing to see is an entertaining event, same as a ballet, opera, movie, what have you. And you can't sue over the content if you don't like it.
That's amazing, man. And that is such a telling result to a lawsuit. I mean, it's right there.
And, you know, that's not the only lawsuit. Other fans have brought lawsuits against the NFL and other leagues and teams for teams trying to move, like the Rams just moved out of St. Louis to Los Angeles.
Yes.
But other lawsuits have been brought up by fans in similar fashions, and fans have lost every time. Every time they've lost the leagues for whatever they're suing them for, because it's the owners own the league and the league is entertainment, and you can't sue if you don't like the end of Star Wars. You know, it's just the way it is.
Yeah. I mean, it's funny you bring up the Rams because I grew up in St. Louis where there's literally nothing to do but follow sports. And funny enough, the Rams, they left in that stadium the taxpayers built for them isn't even paid off. They built the thing in 1995. It cost $280 million. Taxpayers are still on the hook for the entire thing, and it won't be paid off until they're saying 2022. And I mean, you know how much poverty there is in St. Louis? How many shitty old factory buildings with broken windows there are? But yet, this is what we're doing.
Yeah. Well, and that's the thing. I mean, that's a problem with modern-day sports is it's billion-dollar people who own these teams, and yet they somehow are able to con localities, cities, and taxpayers out of money to build them stadiums that only they profit from.
Mm-hmm.
People have fought against it, but many times they lose because fans freak out, because this is almost has a religious effect on people. It almost has a drug-like effect on people, sports does, and they've studied it. They could show it. They call it basking in reflective glory.
Mm-hmm.
And that's basically you get almost like a high, or you get a higher self-worth when the team or player you root for does well. And you can see it. I mean, especially if you call into like sports radio shows, when you hear people say, we need to do this.
Yes.
We need to make this trade. And you're not on the team, buddy. nothing personal, but you're not on the teams. But they have that thing in them, this kind of psychological thing that they are part of the team just because they buy a jersey or wear a hat or go see a game. But that's how the leagues make their profit, is they have these people kind of hooked drug-like on what it is they offer.
Right. And they always use that line that sports teams bring money into the city, but that's not statistically true. Almost anything sports-related carries a heavy licensing fee, and statistics show people come to the games and, for the most part, just go home, which is all, like you said, private revenue. I found this to quote Michael Leeds, who is a sports economist at Temple University. If you ever had a consensus in economics, this would be it. There is no impact. Even in as big a sports town as there is, with five major teams, he says, if every sports team in Chicago were to suddenly disappear, the impact on the Chicago economy would be a fraction of 1%. A baseball team has about the same impact on a community as a mid-sized department store.
Well, and that's true. I mean, other people smarter, much smarter than I, have studied this, sports economists and whatnot, and they've basically proven that adding a team like Los Angeles just added the Rams doesn't really help Los Angeles, and St. Louis really won't be hurt by the Rams leaving. There's no net gain or net loss when a team moves in or moves out of a city. That entertainment money that winds up being spent on the sports team, if the team leaves, winds up being spent on something else.
Mm-hmm.
Some other form of entertainment, whatever there is. And like you say, it doesn't necessarily help the community immediately around the stadium in many cities, because the stadium's basically built right off a highway. There's not really a municipality around there to mm-hmm. visit. So yeah, the economic gain that they purport just doesn't really exist. But mm-hmm. yet, it's enough of a selling point to get people to buy into their lies.
Right. And you mentioned the billionaire owners. You know, in the conspiracy world, we're always talking about ruling families. Are there similar families in sports ownership?
Well, in a sense, I mean, there's longtime owners in the NFL, like the Mara family, which owns the Giants, the Bidwells that own the Cardinals, the Rooneys that own the Steelers, the McCaskey family, which is the Hallis family that owns the Bears. I mean, they've been in it for the long haul. And there's other sports as well that have had long-time ownership. But, I mean, there is more turnover, but the NFL is the one that has the longest kind of history with certain families being in control and doing what it is they do.
Hmm. That's an interesting side note. But yeah, you also mentioned this earlier, talking about how the structure of the leagues can be quite telling, that, you know, not every team is its own competing company. They're all under the same umbrella of the league. Maybe elaborate on that and why it's such a red flag.
It's funny, that actually came up in a Supreme Court case with the NFL, and the NFL's lawyers argued in front of the Supreme Court and said, look, we are not 32 individual teams. We are one entity, and that entity is the National Football League, and our business is entertainment. And they basically flat out said that. So who am I to take them not at their word? If that's what they want to call themselves, that's what they are. But that's not the way fans look at it.
Right.
I live in Wisconsin. The Packer fans, they believe they're their own clan, and their mortal enemies are the Minnesota Vikings and the Chicago Bears and the Detroit Lions, and that's the way it is. But in fact, they're all part of the same family. The Lions, the Bears, the Packers, Vikings, they're all part of the same family. They're all part of the NFL. They all share revenue. About 80% of all revenue the NFL makes is shared amongst all the teams. So if you go buy a Packers t-shirt online, 80% of that money really gets spread around to every other team in the league.
Hmm.
They're all in it together. Revenue sharing, like I say, is one of the things that I think is a telltale sign that shows that these owners would be willing to manipulate their own games to get certain results because everybody profits from it. I mean, a team that goes 16-0 in the NFL will make the same amount of money as a team that goes 0-16 because of the revenue sharing. Because most of the money is made through broadcast media rights, everybody's making the same amount of money. So there's no loss. You see certain storylines that have cropped up over the years, Patriots after 9/11, the Saints after Hurricane Katrina, you know, even Peyton Manning last year and riding off into the sunset as Super Bowl champion. If they can pitch those storylines and people believe them and it makes more people tune in and watch the games every Sunday, that benefits everybody involved, even though it seems to only be directly benefiting one team, it's actually benefiting them all.
Right, and that's such an amazing point. Something I was definitely going to bring up, being a conspiracy show, largely, you know, any way to connect it is always appreciated. And you're right, you talk about these emotionally charged seasons where the New Orleans Saints just happened to win the Super Bowl after Katrina, or the Patriots after 9/11, these perfect sports stories that follow a lot of disastrous events that some of us have cast doubt on with certain guests, but these things seem to happen too often to be a coincidence.
Well, and that's kind of what got me into it, is I don't believe in coincidence when billions of dollars are attached to it. And that's what it is. I mean, you know, it just boils down to, I mean, how many times can the ball seem to bounce any league's way? Yeah, how many times can LeBron James, the most popular player in the NBA, win the NBA title, or at least be playing for the NBA title, when that's what everybody in the league cares about, is what LeBron James is doing?
Mm-hmm.
Doesn't that seem coincidental to some people that, you know, it just so happens that their number one athlete, like Michael Jordan, kept winning the NBA finals and everybody was a Michael Jordan fan? Didn't that seem to benefit everybody involved? That's the thing, is I just don't believe in the coincidences. Even after the Boston Marathon bombing, there was the whole Boston Strong thing, and the Boston Red Sox went on to win the World Series that year. Isn't that just a little coincidental?
Mm-hmm.
I believe it is. And again, there's billions of dollars at stake and on the line for these guys. And the funny thing is, too, and what a lot of fans forget, is there is proven conspiracies within sports. People like to call me the King of the Sports Conspiracy Theorist.
Yeah.
I don't really like that title totally because I don't see myself as a conspiracy theorist. I'm more of a skeptic. You know, I'm skeptical of what the leagues are feeding me.
True.
As the fan. But, I mean, a true conspiracy, back in the 80s, Major League Baseball, every owner got into a room before the season began with the commissioner and agreed not to pay for anybody else's free agents. They all sat in the room and said, look, we need to make more money. Got to drive down player salaries. Here's what we do. There's like 30 some odd guys becoming free agents. Nobody bid on anybody else's free agents. And to a man, they agreed to do that.
Hmm.
And they did it for 3 years in a row. They made it blatantly obvious that they were doing that, that they wound up getting sued and lost almost $300 million in a resultant lawsuit from the Players Association suing them. But I mean, this is a true conspiracy called collusion, where the owners sat down and said, we don't care about wins, losses, we just care about money, and this is how we're going to make more money. And I mean, it's a proven conspiracy. So for people to say the owners can't agree to do stuff like this, you know what, they have done it, and they did it in hockey, the same thing did it in the NHL even earlier, and it's been alleged that the NFL has done it in the recent past as well. So it's a very true thing that the owners of these leagues can sit down amongst themselves and come to a decision that benefits them all, regardless of how it affects wins and losses.
All right. Yeah, it makes total sense. And we should also clarify the degree to which you think games are rigged or fixed. Where would you say you're at on that? Is it every game? Is it just the important ones?
Well, I think games can be fixed basically on two levels. I think they're fixed for gambling purposes at some points by gamblers, organized crime. And my book, Larceny Games, is about all the FBI files I found related to that.
Mm-hmm.
And then I think on another level, games are fixed by the leagues themselves for television ratings and advertising purposes. And that's what the book The Fix Is In is about. And so, I mean, I think both types of fixes exist, both types of fixes still occur, but I don't think it's professional wrestling. You know, I don't think where everything is fixed, every game, every play, which some people allege, especially with the NFL, because of the point spreads and how Las Vegas seems to always make money off of this stuff.
Hmm.
But I don't think that it's to that degree. I think what happens is the league sees some sort of storyline develop that fans get behind, that the media gets behind, and then they help that along. They assist it. And they do certain things, like it protects certain players. In the NFL, they try to protect certain quarterbacks as much as they can. in the NBA that give guys like LeBron James and Steph Curry a little more room to operate so they can do what it is they do easier, because that's what people want to see. Same thing in hockey. So, I mean, I think sometimes just subtle little things, it's not necessarily fixing so this team wins. It's just manipulating games to make sure certain stars remain to be stars, continue to be stars, and draw people's attention to it all. But then, I mean, you could get into the fighting sports like boxing and MMA, and I think fixing occurs in there all the time, too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's notorious with boxing's background.
Yeah.
And that was something I was going to ask you about in a little bit, but overall, how complacent do you think players, coaches, and referees are? Is there much awareness among them that this is happening, you think?
Well, I mean, with referees, if you want to believe the ex-NBA ref, Tim Donaghy, who was a 13-year vet of the league before he got busted by the FBI for gambling on the NBA games, I mean, he claims that referees are extremely aware of what's going on and what the league wants, and that the league sends not-so-subtle hints to them how to officiate certain games to do the things I was talking about, to give certain teams the benefit of the doubt, to give certain players the benefit of the doubt, to extend playoff series and that sort of thing. He says it's a known thing amongst all the referees, and none of them are really surprised by it, and that's what their job is, and they go out and do it. And that's why I think sometimes you have seen coaches and players freak out after games because of the officiating, and why the leagues fine the players and coaches for complaining about the officiating, because that's the easiest way to control and manipulate these games. Because it's not, again, going back to the crime thing, it's not a crime. There's no law being broken if the league, the employer, tells the referees, the employees, how to do their job. Mm-hmm. And if they do their job, happens to manipulate a game, happens to change the outcome of the game, so be it. There's no bribery involved. There's no law being broken. It's just an employer telling the employee, this is how we want you to do the job. And it affects the game. Maybe that's what they want. You know, I think umpires, referees are very, very aware of these sort of things. And I think they go along with it because that's what they want to do. And I think that's why a lot of the players and coaches go along with some of these things, because how else are they going to make their money?
Right.
They spent their whole life doing this, trying to do this, and now they're here. And, you know, are you going to let that really get in the way of things? I don't know.
Yeah. And I also think that even non-sports fans will have heard at least whispers of the NBA referee scandal with this Tim Donaghy guy you brought up.
Yeah.
Obviously, some things did come out in his case. But outside of that, have there ever really been any player or referee whistleblowers on any of this stuff?
Well, no, that's the amazing part of it. Is, I mean, the NFL claims they've never had a game fixed ever in their nearly 100-year history. That's never happened. And Major League Baseball claims it hasn't happened since the 1919 World Series with the Black Sox. And the other leagues have this similar, you know, it's been 60, 70 years since this sort of thing has happened, which I think is complete nonsense. But the thing is, they can say this and they can get away with saying it because nobody's been arrested or convicted of fixing these games. So it makes it a lot easier to say when you can say, well, show me the proof it's been fixed. Well, there's nobody arrested for it, so there you go. It's never happened. But
right. It's not a crime, even.
Well, there is a crime. There's a law that was passed, so it wasn't a federal crime until 1964.
Oh.
It's called the Sports Bribery Act, and that made it illegal for someone to bribe a coach, a player, or a referee to alter the outcome of a game. But then again, now if a player just decided to fix a game on his own, that's not sports bribery because no one's bribing the guy. He's doing it on his own.
Fair, yeah, or if it's internal.
There's a way to fix the game. And the funny thing is when I got these FBI files, and I, through the Freedom of Information Act, I obtained like over 400 files from the FBI directly related to Sports Bribery Act offenses, basically game fixing. And it covered college, NFL, NBA, Major League Baseball, horse racing, boxing, a lot of different sports. You know, the FBI would write in some of their files, like they believed that a couple major NBA Hall of Famers, Bill Russell and Will Chamberlain, were effectively gambling on the games in which they played in the NBA in the 60s. But the FBI wrote, they're not breaking a federal crime. They're not doing anything we can investigate by doing this. And we're not the police force for the NBA. So they said, who cares? It's not our problem. And they just let it go.
Right.
So, I mean, there have been, I think, a lot of things going on underneath the surface that nobody's necessarily investigating or nobody wants to investigate. And that includes the FBI, because it's not really their purpose to police these sports unless really a crime is being committed. And the leagues don't want to investigate themselves. The sports media doesn't really want to do investigative reporting. And the fans don't want to hear this sort of thing. So it's just allowed to happen because nobody wants to, you know, look for it.
Mm-hmm. And we should take a minute to maybe elaborate on sports gambling. Even though it is largely illegal, this is, of course, the main motivation to fix games. How much money is in play here with sports gambling?
The scary part is nobody knows. That's the really, really frightening part. You know, Nevada, where it's the only state that has legalized single game wagering on any sport you want to bet on, they claim they represent probably maybe 2-3% of all the sports gambling done in the United States. And I think last year they took in like $3-4 billion in bets, which if you extrapolate that out, that means the illegal sports gambling in the United States is perhaps $300-400 billion a year, which is a huge amount of money. I don't necessarily think it's that high, but even if it's $100 billion, which doesn't seem out of the question, that's four times as much money as the NFL, the NBA, Major League Baseball, and the NHL make combined.
Jeez.
And for people to think, fans to think, that that sort of money can't influence a game or won't influence a game, I think you're being pretty naive. Because, again, you look outside of the United States, you look at soccer around the world, you look at tennis, cricket, rugby, even baseball in China, basketball in Europe, game fixing is rampant. It's everywhere. I mean, they're really struggling to keep it under control and under check, yet here in the United States, people act like it's impossible, like it could never happen. And especially if you start talking about college sports, then that's incredibly naive thinking.
Yeah, we're living in a bubble. And you've mentioned that sports gambling is heavily mob controlled, and that's an important piece to this puzzle because it seems the connection between organized crime and sports is pretty much as old as the games themselves, wouldn't you say?
In a sense. I mean, you're right about the organized crime thing and gambling. The FBI estimates that sports gambling is its number one or number two most profitable endeavor that the mob engages in to this day. And though people think of it as being a victimless crime, sports gambling, they don't realize that the money that's going into organized crime's coffers from just average Joe's betting $50 on the game here and there, that's going to prostitution, it's going to loan sharking, it's going to drugs and other things that the organized crime is involved in. But I mean, guys have made connection, especially there's one author by the name of Dan Moldea who wrote this book, Interference, which kind of influenced my work. He talks about how much organized crime had in influencing the NFL from the beginning. Some of the early owners we talked about earlier, like the Bidwell family, the original owner, Charles Bidwell, was a known associate of Al Capone. The patriarch of the Mara family that bought the Giants, he was a bookmaker in New York City when he bought the Giants. So gambling and organized crime have always really been around sports. Two guys who founded the NHL, Arthur Wirtz, whose family still owns the Chicago Blackhawks today, and James Norris, whose father the Norris Trophy is named after and who owned the Red Wings, they were heavily involved with organized crime and boxing in the 1950s. A lot of people just don't realize this history that's very real in professional sports and the connections between owners, leagues, and crime.
And you mentioned this journalist, Dan Moldea. He wrote this book about organized crime fixing in football, and he said it pretty much destroyed his career. Can you talk to us a little bit about that, and have you felt similar effects?
Dan's an interesting guy, to say the least. He was an investigative reporter for a long time, and he wrote a lot of books about organized crime. I think he wrote a book about organized crime and Ronald Reagan, and one about organized crime and like Jimmy Hoffa and that sort of thing. And then he decided to write this book about the NFL in the late 80s. And yeah, it, according to him, if you want to believe Dan, he says it effectively ruined his career. And he said that the reason his career got ruined is because the NFL went out of its way to ruin his career, believe it or not. The NFL actually hired a guy to write a negative review of the book in the New York Times, which destroyed sales of the book. And he sued because he found out that this is what happened. And he sued in the court case. He originally won the court case, but it got appealed and appealed and almost actually wound up in the front of the Supreme Court. But the Supreme Court denied to hear the case. So the lesser ruling was, it was accepted. And that was that Muldea lost his case, but really after that, his writing career was kind of in the tank. And it was all because the NFL went out of its way to try to discredit this book and the research he did, in which he mentioned, you know, when I said the NFL says they've never had a game fixed, Muldea claimed, and this was back in, like, say, the late 80s, that over 70 NFL games he knew had been fixed. Hmm. And he had talked to a lot of the guys who had fixed them. And, of course, the NFL didn't want to hear that because that affects their integrity, so they wanted a way to destroy him. And it's funny, when I was working on larceny games with all these FBI files, I actually called and talked to Muldea. He told me, don't write this book. He said, don't even try. They'll come after you and they'll destroy you too. And I said, well, I'm not too concerned because I don't have much of a career. There's really not much to destroy. If they want to come get me, come get me. But like I said earlier when we were talking, you know, I haven't felt that kind of pressure directly from the league, but I know I'm a known entity. I know I'm a known entity in the NFL. I know I'm a known entity in Major League Baseball. For an article I worked with the Center for Investigative Reporting. And I know ESPN knows who I am and won't have me on.
Hmm.
I've been on a lot of major programs. I've been on Coast to Coast. I've been on Alex Jones. I was even somehow managed to get on the Dan Patrick Show and some other national sports radio shows. But no ESPN national show will touch me. And the major ESPN outlets in Chicago, New York, Los Angeles, they won't have me on either. And that's, again, I don't believe that's a coincidence.
Right.
I believe that's effectively them saying, we don't want this guy on here to talk. Because even if they come and have me on to attack me and say, oh, you know, do you believe in the Loch Ness Monster and you believe in Bigfoot and you believe games are being fixed, it still gives me a chance to tell my side of the story. And so, you know, people hopefully would see through such an attack and say, well, maybe this guy's making a little bit of sense, but they won't have it.
There's got to be this complete quarantine around even questioning it, because the integrity of these leagues and their games is the foundation these billion-dollar structures are built on.
Exactly.
They don't work without that.
No.
So I see why they do it. And while the spotlight has kind of been on the NFL here, let me throw this out. You write in Larceny Games that the NFL is probably the most cutthroat and vigilant about stopping any negative press. And you equate them almost to an intelligence network like the CIA or the FBI. And that's something. You think they're really that advanced?
Yeah, they really are.
Wow.
I mean, NFL security, Major League Baseball security, every league has their own quote-unquote security department. And literally they're staffed with former members of the CIA, FBI, DEA, Secret Service, local law enforcement. I mean, they hire serious, serious dudes to do this sort of work for them. And the funny thing is, they don't exactly operate the way they claim to. I mean, I interviewed a guy by the name of Warren Welsh, who was a former FBI agent and became the head of NFL security. And when I talked to Mr. Welsh, I talked to him for probably an hour. When I hung up the phone after that hour, I still had no idea what NFL security did. Because he talked in such a circuitous way, I just couldn't understand what they really did. And what I've come to pretty much figure out is all of these security departments are there to cover things up, for lack of a better term. They don't want things to get in the press. And you can see this. I mean, I researched this for like 10 years now. But anybody can see, if you see a player arrested or a coach arrested or some sort of scandal breaks out in whatever league it is, you never see law enforcement thank NFL security or thank NBA security for their assistance in helping to bring this to justice. It doesn't happen.
Yeah.
And so if that doesn't happen, and again, I'd love anybody, the NFL, NBA, anybody to prove to me that this is wrong, but I'd love to see that happen, because if that's not what they're doing, then the only thing they must be doing is finding these things out and making them stay quiet and stay under wraps until they explode into the media because of law enforcement, because law enforcement doing real investigation, because these departments of security don't have the ability to subpoena people, they can't get people under oath, that sort of thing. It's basically like their own Gestapo for each of these leagues.
Mm-hmm. Wow. I mean, obviously there's a lot of money involved. We know they have security, but I bet a lot of people haven't thought of it like that. Another thing I was going to say, you mentioned larceny games, and in the intro to that book, you say that to knowledgeable sports fans, some of the names involved in these FBI files that you looked at will be really surprising. Who are some of the people involved that surprised you the most, or you think would shock sports fans?
Well, there was and I'm not going to remember the exact number now because it's been a couple years. But, I mean, there was probably, I want to say, 6 or 8 Hall of Famers in basketball in the NFL that were named in FBI files as potentially either gambling on their own sport, which should have gotten them kicked out of the sport, or potentially fixing games, which also should have gotten kicked out of the sport. Who really, if the FBI files are to be believed, all those guys should be expelled from their respective Hall of Fames, like tomorrow.
Yeah.
And, I mean, the other big name, I think, in the FBI files is Muhammad Ali, because they believed that Muhammad Ali was involved in fixing fights.
Really? That's...
Yeah.
He's a hero to many. People aren't going to want to hear that.
No, well, exactly. The people don't want to hear that. But, again, if you think about the history of boxing and how corrupt that is and how many times they've fixed fights to make other fights happen, why would it be surprising to anyone that Ali would be involved in that in some way, shape, or form? But that's right. What the FBI files showed. And, you know, going back to larceny games in the media, because I like telling the story because I don't often get to, but when that book came out, I mean, I'm the first one to get access to all those files, okay? I was the first one to do it. I actually wound up on a list at the FBI. There's me and like 30 other guys on this list. Because we asked for apparently too many Freedom of Information Act requests. We're on this Bexham filer list that the FBI has. So I'm even known to the FBI now. But when this book was coming out, my publisher was contacted by ESPN, Sports Illustrated, HBO Sports. We're contacted by 60 Minutes. We're contacted by all these different outlets because, again, I was the first one to find this information. Talks about Hall of Fame athletes gambling on their own sport or fixing games. This is not stuff I've made up. This is the FBI's investigative work. It should be pretty reliable for at least to some people. Some people don't trust the FBI, but let's trust them for the moment. So we were contacted by all these different sports outlets, and then not a single one of them covered the book in any way, shape, or form.
Wow.
No one wrote a review of it. No one said this book is the worst thing written. Nobody says this is the best thing written. Nobody followed up on any of the stuff I had written about except for the New York Post. The New York Post found one story in my book about members of the New York Knicks in the early 80s fixing games, shaving points as a favor to their cocaine dealer. And the New York Post picked up on that, wrote a story about it, which went viral, which surprised the heck out of me. And literally after the author contacted me, said, okay, you know, the story's up on the New York Post website. Like 20 minutes later, he said, oh, you know, Sports Illustrated picked up on this. And it went viral. And it went everywhere except on ESPN's websites. ESPN refused to touch that story. Of course, ESPN is also the prime broadcast partner of the National Basketball Association. So why would they want a story, even if it's a 30-year-old story, but a story about NBA players, cocaine, point shaving, and all that stuff, potentially scarring their image and scarring their broadcast partner's image? But it's the truth. Anybody can go out and you can Google Knicks point shaving cocaine, and you'll see that article repeated ad nauseum, but you won't see it on ESPN.
It's funny how that works out.
Yeah. But I mean, again, that shows I'm just writing about sports, and that happens to me. When people are writing about more important things, what's happening to them?
Right. Amen.
That's what
Amen.
Concerns me. That's my worry, is it's like, geez, this is just sports. Who cares? You know, I mean, it's a 30-year-old basketball game. Who cares? Well, apparently ESPN still cares. The NBA still cares. And that should make you a little worried.
It should. And, you know, money's money and billionaires are billionaires. So They got their ways of getting it. So I did want to step back to Ali for a minute because he is such a holy figure in sports. And some people might still be twitching from those claims that he wasn't on the up and up. Are there any specific fights or specific claims against him that you remember?
Well, against him specifically, it really goes to when he fought Spinks at the end of his career. Really, the first two major fights he had against Sonny Liston, when he originally won the heavyweight championship, and then his very next fight, in which he defended it against Liston, both those fights are fixed. Liston took a dive in both of them. There's that ultimate famous picture of Ali standing over Liston, basically telling them to get up. I think everybody thinks of when they think of, well, that was Liston took a dive. Muhammad Ali was telling them to get up because he knew he didn't hit Liston. Liston was just laying there.
Really?
that's the story behind that picture. Yeah, wow. It wasn't a straight fight. Liston was heavily owned by organized crime and the mob, and he threw the first heavyweight championship fight, and he actually owned a piece of Ali's next fight, which wouldn't have been worth anything if he beat Ali in that initial heavyweight championship fight, because then Ali would have been nothing. So he threw to the fight, gave Ali the title, and then was involved in the rematch, and then threw that fight as well. But going back to Ali and Spinks, when the FBI files I found was a member of Spinks's camp. And you have to remember, this is, I think, what, 80, 81, somewhere in there. Ali was old. He wasn't really in good shape. And Spinks had had something like 7 or 8 professional fights, and yet he was given a shot at the heavyweight title against Ali, which made no sense. And he beat Ali, and he won the heavyweight title. And before their rematch, one of Spinks's entourage, that doesn't really exist, I don't remember if it says it specifically in the file or not, came to the FBI and said, look, this rematch is fixed. And he said, this is how the fight's going to play out, and Ali's going to win his heavyweight title back. And he said, if this is really is what happens, he goes, I'll come back to you, FBI, and I'll give you more information. And the guy was 100% accurate. He was dead on right what happened in that fight. But apparently he never went back to the FBI, and the FBI closed the file.
Wow.
So they didn't care. And there's other people. There's actually some other people who have confirmed, pretty much, I mean, not to some people's ears, but have confirmed that Ali threw with the original Spinks fight to give Spinks the heavyweight title, so he could beat him in the rematch to be the first person to ever win the heavyweight crown 3 times.
Damn, man.
I know. Well, people tell me I ruin sports for them, so I apologize now if it's, you know, affecting people and you. The way it goes.
There might be a few people screaming into their smartphones, but I say, let's shatter those illusions.
Yeah.
And another point about the mob being heavily involved, talk to us about Lefty Rosenthal. He used to fix games quite a bit. There's a couple of good stories about him. He's actually the character Robert De Niro is based on in Casino. Tell us what you know about him.
Yeah, Lefty was a known game fixer as well. He was one of the mafia's favorite gamblers to a certain extent. But Lefty, he was kind of a character. I mean, he allegedly would, because he worked the college circuit, he wasn't involved in fixing professional games, because back when he was operating, which was the 1950s, professional games didn't mean as much. Mm-hmm. People forget that too. You know, the NFL in the 1950s paled in comparison in popularity to college football, and same with basketball. The NBA was nothing compared to college basketball. College basketball was huge, and Lefty was involved in fixing games in both college football and basketball. He would actually get college basketball players to practice missing layups, so it looked more convincing when they did it. I mean, that's a guy who's working for his money there. Get kids to practice missing the layup so it looked more realistic when they did throw up a brick like that. And there's a story, too, which I heard from two different people, although it involved two different teams, but essentially the same story, that Rosenthal was based a lot of times around Chicago, and it was either, I think, Oklahoma or it was Michigan, I think, were the two competing teams. One or the other was coming to Chicago to play Northwestern. And Rosenthal actually invited that visiting team out to dinner, the whole team, to a restaurant in Chicago, and then poisoned them. And he had bet heavily on Northwestern to win, who were the underdog, and he gave food poisoning to the entire other team, be it Michigan or Oklahoma, I forget which one it was, and won his bet. Because he fixed the game by poisoning the kids.
Bold move.
Yeah, it's a great move. I even heard actually that that happened in the NFL at one point in time in the 70s. That a similar thing that I think it was Tampa Bay was visiting the Vikings, and that supposedly a couple of guys gave food poisoning to Tampa Bay to make sure that the Vikings covered and won their game.
That's nuts. And logistically, if you wanted to rig a game, how many players on a team do you need in your pocket to do it effectively, do you think?
Well, that's a good question. It depends what, I suppose, you're trying to do. I mean, if you're just trying to, like, shave points, which is, for gambling purposes, really the main thing to do, if you have one basketball player, you have 20% of the team. And a team operating at 100% can probably beat the team operating at 80%, right? I mean, that's all you need. You need one dude. And, I mean, in the NFL, I think you can do it if you just had a quarterback. Or I even think you could do it if you just had an offensive lineman. But I had one gambler tell me, look, you give me a quarterback, an offensive lineman, and a defensive back for a team, and I can fix any game out there. Just give me those three players on the team.
Hmm.
I think even referees, you get a single referee who throws a flag at the right time or calls the right type of fouls, and you can manipulate a game. I think the hardest one, teams-wise, to fix would probably be something like baseball, because even if you had a pitcher in your pocket and he gave up 8 runs in 2 innings, it doesn't mean the team won't come back and score 9. Yeah. But if you're just trying to shade things in your favor as a gambler, and that's what a lot of sports gamblers are always looking for, just that slight edge, if you had a pitcher in your pocket and he did give up 8 runs, you'd still feel pretty confident that that other team's not going to come back and score tonight. Not saying it couldn't happen, but it does help your cause, that's for sure.
Right, and slight edge really is a key term here, because I was really shocked by the statistics of sports betting, that you're only aiming to be right like 55% of the time, and each percentage point is an insane multiplier. You have a breakdown from a professional gambler named Steve Fresnick, and he says that if you had just a 60% record and you took $1,000 and bet 10% of your bankroll on a game a day, which is a pretty aggressive schedule, in 5 years, just being right 60% of the time, you'd have $550 billion. I mean, Jesus, man, that doesn't even really seem possible.
Well, that's the amazing thing with sports gambling and why I think a lot of people question Las Vegas's connection to leagues like the NBA and the NFL, is because you have to win almost 53% of your bets to be profitable. And that doesn't seem like much, because that's basically like a coin toss, you know, just a little above 50-50, 53%. How hard is that?
Yeah.
But, I mean, really, in the long haul, they've shown that even the best guys, the guys who do this professionally, have an incredibly hard time of winning over 55 to 60% of their bets in the course of a season or longer, especially longer. The longer it goes out, the worse people do. I mean, people can go on streaks where they can win 100% of their bets, short enough streak, but some guys can have incredible streaks, and they've seen seasons where guys can hit 70% of their bets. They're not necessarily betting like the way that guy I talk about in the book says you would, because that's kind of crazy betting as it is. But it is. It's very difficult to make a living as being a sports gambler. A lot of people, I think it's easy because it's like, oh, all you got to do is pick a winner. How hard is that? Well, try it. Try beating the points spread. Don't bet money doing it. Just keep track of it in a book and see how well you do, because you'd be surprised. It's not as easy as it looks. These guys who do it spend a large amount of time breaking down games and analyzing certain factors to get what they find, like you say, just that little X factor that seems favorable in their side, and then they bet it. Because they're not betting all 16 games every Sunday on the NFL. They may look at all 16 games and bet one. They may bet zero because they don't see an edge anywhere. So it just kind of depends.
And you mentioned that baseball could be one of the harder ones to rig. Are there sports you think are most susceptible to rigging?
Well, I think individual ones like boxing, UFC. I think, again, boxing's proven. Tennis is another one because that's an individual sport where, again, you get to one person and you got the game. Like I say, if you look at it internationally, soccer, which I would think is extremely hard to fix, apparently is extremely easy to fix. I don't understand how you fix a soccer match when you got 11 guys seemingly running around in all different directions on each side. But yet they're so good, these guys who are fixing soccer matches. In some cases, they can literally say, we want this game to end 3-1, and the game will end 3-1 because that's what they fixed it for. It's one of those things where, you hate to say it, but wherever there's money involved, corruption will follow. So it's just a matter of how much money can you make, how much will it cost you to potentially alter the outcome of the game, and you do the math. And then you can go out there, and a lot of times, I mean, I don't think you could just fix a game because you want to fix a game. I think obviously you have to have an in, but if you look at human nature, you know, everybody has a weakness. And it doesn't matter if you're Peyton Manning, doesn't matter if you're Tom Brady or LeBron James, everybody's got problems, everybody has weaknesses, and if somebody finds a way to exploit that and press the right buttons, you can get people to do things you'd think were impossible.
Always. Nothing new under the sun. And I wanted to ask you about a couple specific events in sports that might give us some insight that I've heard you talk about a little bit before. For example, LeBron's last game. What do you think's up with that?
Well, what do you mean LeBron's? You mean Kobe Bryant's?
Oh, I'm sorry. See, that's how little I know about sports. Yeah, I mean Kobe Bryant's.
Yeah, I don't think LeBron's done yet. I think he still goes. Kobe Bryant's last game, I mean, he had like a victory tour going away party this whole past season. Why, I don't know, but that's what the NBA wanted, and for some reason that's what other teams allowed to happen. And then in this final game, it was absurd. If a true basketball fan looked at that final game and he scored something like, I can't remember now, 60 points or something like that, I think, and looked at the game, I mean, you would realize there was no way that game was really legitimate. Like, it was a really legitimate NBA basketball game. Because, yeah. I mean, that just sort of thing happens. I think Kobe Bryant took the most shots of any player in that game for like the past 20 or 25 years. They were basically saying, this is Kobe's final game. Kobe's going to do what the fans wanted to see him do. I mean, he was in at home in L.A. The fans wanted him to go out with a bang, and he went out with a bang, and the NBA gave him exactly what they wanted. And if that doesn't prove to fans that this is just show business entertainment, what else can?
Right. I think that's a great case study.
It is, because if you're going to tell me that every game counts and every game matters, explain that Kobe Bryant game to me, because you can't. I don't think you can make a valid argument for it for anything but entertainment and a show and a production. And then if you say, well, it was just the final game and it's a meaningless game, then you're on the slippery slope. Well, tell me then what other games were meaningless, what games were meaningful, which matters. I mean, you can't, once you open that can of worms, like I said, I could be wrong 99% of the time, but if I'm right that 1% of the time, then you, Mr. Sports Fan, have problems.
Yeah, I mean, what about the other team?
Yeah, exactly.
Right, they don't care it's Kobe's last game.
Yeah, who told them to lay down? And why did they listen?
Yeah, that's a great one. You also have an interesting take on Jordan's first retirement. Tell us a little bit about that.
Sorry. I would laugh at that.
No, it's cool.
Well, it's just, I've lived in and around Chicago basically my whole life, and Michael Jordan, when he was on the Bulls and the NBA, he was a god. And, I mean, people forget, I think, because now it's been a few years, he wasn't just a Chicago Bull. He literally was the NBA. And he wasn't really just the NBA. He was also McDonald's and Chevrolet and Nike and all the other endorsement deals he had. The guy meant a lot of money to a lot of people. And it's pretty much been proven that Michael Jordan has a gambling problem. He's a compulsive gambler. And my argument is, and I don't actually think it's an argument, I think it's the reality of the situation, is that he was gambling while he was playing in the NBA. And he was known to be gambling on golf and losing money at golf to a known cocaine dealer, for one, and another shady character he owed about $1 million to from playing golf, who was basically a hustler. And a lot of people think he was gambling on sports as well, and potentially even gambling on NBA games. And this kind of started to come out in the news, at least the gambling on golf did. And my belief is the NBA came in, held meetings with Jordan and the owner, Jerry Reinsdorf, the owner of the Bulls, and basically said, we got to shut Jordan down because we can't have this huge scandal erupt because it's too much money to too many people. And so we're going to make Jordan go away. So his father had been killed. There's actually speculation that his father was killed because of his gambling and because of his connections to this cocaine dealer and what have you. But his father was killed, so it kind of gave Jordan an out. And Jordan said, I'm going to retire. My dad's got to see my last game, et cetera, et cetera. I want to spend more time with my family and my wife, who he's now divorced from. He never spent time with his family. He wound up playing baseball for Chicago Bulls owner's minor league baseball team. But basically, I think he never retired. He was forced out of the NBA to get help and to make this gambling problem go away. And once he did retire, the NBA's investigation into all this vanished. The sports media's investigation into all this vanished. And then when he came back a little over a year later, they just picked up and were like, hooray, Michael Jordan's back. And nobody remembered the gambling thing that happened. And it just vanished.
Wow. I love it, man. I love the possible notorious subtext to these major storylines that hit the mainstream. And I got sucked into the Bulls, too, and as a kid in the Midwest. Jordan, Pippen, Rodman, Kerr, Kukoc. I liked that team. It was when that team fell apart that I was like, okay, I can't follow sports anymore. Am I supposed to just care about everybody for all time? Every replacement is never going to end.
I mean, that's the thing, especially with Jordan, because Jordan was a special entity. But at the same time, when you talk about manipulating games and the league manipulating games, I got a couple of videos, I think they're still up on my website, where you can watch the way they officiated Jordan was not like the way they officiated everybody else. They made sure he was successful because, again, he meant money to everybody. So the officiating was different for Michael Jordan than it was for everybody else. And if you can do that, if you want to say, okay, well, that's helping Michael Jordan, well, that's helping the Bulls, and that's helping, that's affecting wins and losses, that's affecting a lot of things. And I think you could see that again today with a lot of players, LeBron and Steph Curry and some of these other guys. It's the same situation because the NBA is star driven and they need those stars for people to tune in and watch. They need the Kobe Bryants. They need that sort of pomp and circumstance surrounding it. So the only way to ensure that happens is when a player does catch on, you give them a little extra space, and wins or losses be damned, you want to make sure that guy succeeds.
Yeah, it makes sense. And I don't know the name of the team, but you mentioned one NFL team who had a great season, and turns out they never had a holding call. That's something critics should probably look at, right?
Well, that was the Green Bay Packers. It wasn't that they never had a holding call. It was the year they almost went undefeated. They went 15-1, but then they lost the very first playoff game. It was a couple seasons ago. I forget which. But I just happened to be tracking penalties in the NFL because people sometimes call me crazy for saying these games are fixed. And I'm like, look, you have a subjective penalty in the NFL, like pass interference. You have a subjective penalty, like offensive holding. I was like, how often do these things occur and how do they affect the outcome of a game? Well, the year that the Packers went 15-1, there was 11 of the 16 games in which they played. Offensive holding was never called on the Green Bay Packers. And this is a penalty that a lot of NFL pundits would say happens on every play, if not at least on every other play. So how is it that the Green Bay Packers, who happen to be led by a star quarterback in Aaron Rodgers, go 11 games without a single offensive holding call against their line? That should be impossible. Mm-hmm. It shouldn't happen. And amazingly, again, because they didn't have a lot of penalties called against them, they had amazing success. And of course, when the NFL's trying to build its star quarterbacks, doesn't it help when you got a guy like Aaron Rodgers get a little extra time, a little extra protection, and doesn't get penalized for that extra time and protection because his offensive line is cheating because nobody's calling the cheating on him. That's how games get manipulated. And like I say, it may not be being done to make sure the Packers win. It may be being done just to help Aaron Rodgers succeed, but those things kind of go hand in hand. So,
yeah,
you know, make up your own mind on that.
Seems a little bit obvious to me. And let's say forcing games to a 7-game series in the playoffs, that seems to happen quite often, right?
It seems to. I mean, it's probably not as often as people think, but it probably happens more often than it should.
Which is never, really, if you're being honest.
Well, in many ways. I mean, there was a guy, he worked for the Rand Corporation, of all things, back in the 60s. He wrote an investigative paper on whether or not the World Series had been fixed. And this is, again, back in the late 60s. And his argument was that the World Series was going to Game 7 more often than it should have. And this was before Major League Baseball had all the other playoff series. It just had a World Series. And he said, look, if it's being fixed, the reason to be fixed would basically for all the reasons we've been talking about. You know, more ticket sales, more beer sales, more parking, more revenue, more money, basically, for the league. And through his statistical analysis, which I cannot follow for the life of me because it's been too many years since I had my calculus class in high school. But his conclusion was that, yeah, the World Series had reached Game 7 more often than it should have. And this was back in the 60s. And actually, during the 70s and early 80s, Game 7 occurred even more often in the World Series. And so you base it on what you want. But this guy back in the 60s said this is happening because of the same reasons we're discussing today. But again, sports fans don't want to hear it. Sports media doesn't want to cover it because that's how they make their money.
Right. So what do you consider to be, if you had to pick one of the biggest fixed games in sports history?
I think one of the biggest ones for a business purpose, my opinion, is Super Bowl III, which was the Joe Namath Super Bowl where he guaranteed the win. Because it was back then that the NFL was merging with this rival league, the AFL, which became the AFC, and the NFL became the NFC, today's modern NFL. But they were two rival leagues at the time, and they were merging, and a lot of people, a lot of fans, I should say, didn't buy the AFL in terms of credibility. It had only been around for about less than 10 years, and fans weren't accepting of their brand of football. And so the owners of both leagues were concerned because there was a lot of money at stake. And after they played the first two Super Bowls in which the NFL champions, which happened to be the Packers, basically just wiped the field with the AFC's challengers, there was real concern. So when it came to the Super Bowl III, the Baltimore Colts were the representative for the NFL, and the Colts were literally, to this day, one of the greatest NFL teams that ever played. And yet they lost the Super Bowl to the Jets and Joe Namath, which were the third place AFL team that season. And I think that game was fixed, and I think it was fixed to make sure that the Jets won because it helped save the merger in the owners' minds. It helped legitimize the AFL to the NFL fans, and it literally created the modern-day NFL. And if you look at it as business, which is how, again, we've been talking about, you should look at these things as business, that was the best business decision to make, was to make sure that game wound up with the Jets winning because of all the money it meant to everybody involved.
Wow. I wouldn't be surprised. That's an interesting saga.
As you say, just say I'm right with that one game, okay? that game was fixed for the Jets, and no other game has been fixed in the NFL since that point in time. You still have to question the NFL's integrity.
Yeah.
Because if they did that the one time for business reasons, that's all you need to make you say, well, what about this game? What about that game? What about anything? Because if you did it once, it's like having a spouse that cheats on you. I only cheated on you once, honey. Well, you're okay, but where are you going tonight?
Right, you know what I mean?
That's all it takes. It's just one time, and it throws everything for a loop. And I think smart fans, if they've been watching sports, especially in this day and age with the HD TVs and the instant replays and that sort of thing, and they haven't seen enough crazy calls made by officials and the way things work out for certain teams and certain players at certain times, and don't think that something's going on behind the scenes to make sure that happens, I think you see it more often than you'd believe. Once you start looking for it, you can't not see it.
Mm-hmm. I mean, you've pointed out some great examples so far. And the last random sports event I wanted to ask you about is Tyson biting Holyfield's ear. I haven't ever really heard you comment on this, but you can't argue that this is one of the strangest things and one of the biggest media firestorms to come out of sports. I've heard there's a lot of corruption in Tyson's career in general with his management and Don King and stuff. But do you have any thoughts, any deeper thoughts on that situation with Tyson and Holyfield?
Actually, no. That's one thing you're the first person I think to ever ask me about that. That was just, I think, just too weird for words is what it boils down to. I mean, obviously Tyson's not, I met him once, but he's just not normal. I mean, I think he's just one of those guys that's just not right. And I think that was just when the moments that not right in his head took over and we saw what happened from it. But I mean, I don't think that was staged. I don't think that was, you know, hey, Mike, go in there, bite his ear off. I just think that was one of those things that happened. And that's the problem. Anyway, when you talk about these fixed sporting defenses, you know, guys have bad games. I mean, strange things do happen in games. And sometimes the underdog is going to upset the favorite. I mean, it doesn't mean games are fixed because certain things happen, but again, I think you have to start looking at it more rationally as a fan, and then some of these things will, again, jump out at you as being just a little too coincidental for your liking.
And as weird as that one was, you're right. Maybe there's nothing deeper there. Maybe the guy who tattooed his face also just bit a man's ear.
Yeah.
You know, go figure.
Yeah, there are just weird people out there.
Man. Well, do you have any predictions or anything based on patterns that you've seen in this type of sports fixing? You've been looking at it for so long. Any championships you see happening based on your study?
People ask me that all the time, and I run into problems making predictions because if I predict something and it's right, then a lot of times I'll hear, well, everybody knew that. Everybody knew that was going to happen. And then if I predict something and it's wrong, then they say, well, you see, you don't know what you're talking about. So I can never win making predictions because I get one or the other. And I kind of predicted the Saints would play the Colts in the Super Bowl when that happened halfway through the season. And that was one of those situations where everybody said, well, everybody knew that would happen because they were the two best teams. That's still pretty good prediction on my part. But for me, because I don't think necessarily that a league like the NFL or the NBA will say, we're going to have Team X win. We're going to fix the entire season to make sure this team wins. I don't think they do that. I think, like I said, they'll see something develop naturally. And I think the Golden State Warriors this past season, they were an excellent team. I don't think the NBA really had to rig much to get them into the finals. I think they were just that good of a team, so they went with it. That was a good storyline. But, I mean, I think other things, like you say, like the Saints after Hurricane Katrina, that's one of those things where maybe the league said, look, this is a good story. We can milk it. Here, let's, if we can give them a little help here, give them a little help in this game, we can push them a little farther than they need to be. Then that's good business. Then they will step in and do those sorts of things. So I think it's kind of an opportunity that they see, and when it crops up, that's when they'll push certain things into being. But I mean, to say that the Raiders are going to win the Super Bowl because I think it's fixed for them to win, I don't think that's the case at this point in time. But I think if you watch sports and you watch how the media covers it and the pregame shows and how certain players and teams are hyped, I think you can usually get a good sense, actually, of the way things might be being pushed, because those are the best stories for the league, and that's what they think is going to drive the most fans to their televisions and make them the most money.
Yeah, it makes total sense. Right on. Well, very cool. That just about does it for us, man. But before we go, do remind the people about your website and the numerous books you got out there if they want to dig deeper into the topic.
Well, the best place to go, my website is thefixisin.net, and all my books are there. They're all a mouthful in terms of actual titles, but the short titles, The Fix Is In, Larceny Games, and Season in the Abyss are the sports books. And like I say, you can find them on thefixisin.net, and the books are available at Amazon and Barnes & Noble and hopefully your local bookstore. Wherever good books are sold, you can find them. And then there's a lot of information, like you said, on my website that people can just read for free if they're interested. And if they want to email me, too, I'm always open to questions. My email's on the website, too. They can find it there.
Awesome, Brian. Well, thanks so much. This has been a great show. Very unique. I loved it. A real treat for me and anyone else who might feel a bit jaded from growing up around sports fanatics and always felt like the odd man out. But thanks again, man. Do be careful out there. Messing with people's money can be a dangerous thing.
Yes, it can. Well, thank you, Greg. I appreciate you having me on.
You got it. Take care, man.
Have a good night.
There it is, people. Brian Tuohy, great guest, right? Kind of a show that's just for fun. Maybe some people will hear this and say, you know what? I have sort of made this random sports team a big part of my life or identity, and maybe I'm getting played here. I know I used to love Pawn Stars until I was watching an episode where someone pawned a Dreamcatcher and then later they returned to buy it back, and I thought, hey, that item that he was handed back looked a little different, and sure enough, I looked it up online, several other people had found the same thing, the color of the feathers were different, and the illusion was broken, and I never watched Pawn Stars again. Saved myself hours. A similar thing happened with Storage Wars. You really think they're finding all these gems and first edition Spider-Mans in these bullshit storage containers that people decided to stop paying on? Come on. And if these shows are staged, there's literally no enjoyment left. And I hope some people have started to think more about sports in that sense after listening to Brian. It's the legal framework I find most interesting. It's illegal to offer a bribe from outside the organization, but then in the lawsuit about football games and their integrity, it was ruled that if you pay to see a football game and you see one, that's it. It doesn't have to be fair. It doesn't have to be real. It's just entertainment and the illusion of competition. But I can't harp on it too much. I don't want to come off as smug and arrogant. Believe me, I have plenty of stupid time-wasting hobbies, and I watch plenty of bad shows. Between my surprise that David didn't end up with Sarah on the latest season of Naked Dating and my 200th game of Overwatch, I'm not really stepping up to cast the first stone here. But I like to sniff out corruption, examine the way people are manipulated, and cover rarely discussed topics, and I think we hit a trifecta tonight. I believe it was in the plus half of the show where we talked about the connection between sports and politics. I can't really remember, but it did make me think back to the Russ Baker show about the Bush family and how a major factor in getting George W. elected governor of Texas was his association with the Texas Rangers. You got a bunch of screaming fans, you put this smiling moron on the Jumbotron and his name on the ballot, and people just vote for the guy that they see at the games. I hate to think it's that simple, but I think we all know that it kind of is. So it's not just harmless fun here. We should remember that. And that's going to put the capstone on the September pyramid for THC. We got pretty good shows. Mary Joyce with underground military bases and little people legends in the North Carolina area. The sixth triumphant return of Gordon White, talking largely about Campfire's Edge and Pieces of Eight. Scott Santons with the Universal Basic Income Exploration Show. Walter Bosley and the Origins of the Breakaway Civilization. And now Brian Tuohy with Sports Conspiracy Goodness. I think September was a great month. Maybe you'll finally sign up for THC Plus and get what you've been missing. If you've been missing it, I don't know. It's an easy process. You can sign up at thehighersidechatsplus.com, and you can also see the first five sites from the Graham Hancock Armenia trip last year. Got that going this month too, so I'm feeling good, feeling accomplished. And I hope you're feeling good too. Keep your head up, your feet moving, and your pimp hands strong. And hopefully the Rockefeller-Rothschild cog-in-the-wheel reality will be a distant memory for more and more of us going forward. But the game on Sunday is a distraction to keep you from escaping the trap of work on Monday. Don't fall for it, people! I've done all I can. Your move, sorcerers of the sports spell, distraction dealers, and fix facilitators for the sad, sad world of entertainment addicts. Your fucking move.
Well, they tie that yellow ribbon round the oak tree. They've worn out all the prayer in their hearts. All along thought they were rooting for the home team. As they're sent to the game and torn apart, we twist this tourniquet upon the pipeline that he carries on.
Yeah.